So everybody went around the room and kind of introduced themselves. As Matt and Matt said, I work with the Matts.
Matt Square.
And my name is Tom Towns. I work on the infrastructure team, and we do primarily the server management for our QA servers, do all the deployments daily, those types of things, as well as our team does all of the installer changes for our product. We have a health insurance product that's an enterprise class kind of system, so it runs health insurance companies like Blue Cross Blue Shields or lines of business for like an Aetna or something like that. So it has about what, seven different modules that you deploy, independent or semi-independent.
How many developers?
We have somewhere in the neighborhood about 20 or 30 actual programmers,
Across the globe, then?
and then two locations in Phoenix, and mostly in Phoenix. There's a few scattered remote workers throughout the country, but less than a half a dozen. And then we have teams in Chennai, India, as well. We're owned by a company called Cognizant, which is a consulting company. And so they have most of their employees are actually in India, somewhere in India, but they are a US-based company, or they're incorporated in, I think, New Jersey is where it's at. So we just transitioned over to yet another offshore group about a year and a half ago. That was our third in about 6 years. So we've had plenty of practice doing that. But they're finally coming up to speed, and we'll be able to, or are being productive now. So, but our application is pretty large. It's about 15 million lines of code. Databases have about 2,000 tables plus in it. So there's I think about somewhere close to about 150 to 160 people overall, both onshore and offshore, that work on the product.
Wow.
So, and then we say we ship internationally, but not really. We ship to Puerto Rico.
English speaking.
Excuse me. It's kind of like international, right? We also have clients in Hawaii, which people want to go do that, but not lately. I think they got snow this past weekend. So, yep. So,
top of the mountain is 12,000 plus feet, so it's gonna happen.
I think it's down the bottom corner, Tom, right by 95, if you're looking for a full screen.
I was looking to do the slideshow. I'll just hit F. I think thought it was F5, but
what's down
that
the
icon
corner?
right there? Yeah, was it?
Yeah, there you go.
I try to use the
Okay,
shortcut.
that's the icon.
So somehow it's using PowerPoint online, not actually downloading the file.
You can download it to the desktop on that if you want.
It's got in the pop-up stuff, it stopped it from going full screen.
And F11.
Another slide out from there.
Yeah, see, it didn't open it.
There's a toolbar there.
Yeah.
Down
Slide
to the left there. Right there. Over.
Yeah, but this is, I'm in PowerPoint online within the browser, and I was
yeah,
hoping
that
to.
option's highlighted.
Yeah,
it's
so here's a pop-up
yeah.
stopper. It stopped the pop-up on
Oh,
the screen.
okay.
So
There
if
you
you
go.
just allow that, always allow pop-up from this website.
Yeah, go ahead.
Done. And then now try that again.
There we go.
Maybe.
Yeah, it's full screen as you're going to get.
Okay. We'll see how this works. Not use this PowerPoint online. So as Tom said, talking about Azure and Azure Resource Manager, and I'd asked at the last meeting how many people had any experience with Azure or Azure Resource Manager or the templates. Nobody really had much experience with that. So I put some very high-level summary information together about Azure and kind of Resource Manager. If it's not interesting or if people already know this, just let me know. Raise your hand anytime throughout the discussion too. Just let me know, and I'll be happy to answer any questions as best I can. I'm not going to say I'm an expert, and certainly things change every day, if not every hour, within Azure. So even if you're an expert yesterday on something, you may not know what it is today. So unfortunately, there's a lot to keep up with. It's good that they're constantly adding things to it. So the agenda that I put together is just to do an Azure overview, resource manager overview, look at the Azure portals. There's a couple of different ways to use a web browser to open up Azure and look at the resources and the artifacts and the services that you're taking advantage of and you've configured. Deploy a virtual machine within Azure Resource Manager using the portals. Then deploy a virtual machine using PowerShell so that you can see how to do that. Deploy a virtual machine using a template via PowerShell, so that's a little bit different. Create Azure Resource Manager templates within Visual Studio, because there's several different ways you can create these. And then if we have time, we'll get to a template that I created that allows you to deploy any number of copies of the same virtual machine, basically, in Azure. So if you need 10 within a resource group, a grouping of services within Azure, you can deploy it. You can redeploy as well, which is kind of neat. And then we can do a review at the end. Any questions that we didn't get to during the discussion? And we'll see how the time goes. So Azure, as most people know, is Microsoft's public cloud. They have a homepage that you can access that just basically takes you to their overall description of what it is. Gives you a lot of information. You get documentation, detailed documentation. You look at all the products and services, you know, how to get started. There's videos. There's videos on Channel 9. There's videos on YouTube. But basically, Azure contains 67 types of products. So a virtual machine is a product. A network interface is a product. A private network is a product. Right? So some of those, as I said, virtual machines, a SQL database, not a SQL database on a VM in Azure, but actually an Azure SQL database, so a database instance running in Azure that's different. A DocumentDB type of database. So if you're using JSON or something else, or the NoSQL types of databases, they have those out there. You can just create storage to store blobs or tables or create a network share up in Azure. So if you wanted to create your own kind of Dropbox, if you want to, you can do that type of thing as well, but access it as a Windows network share. You can back up VMs not only in Azure, but you can back up on-premise VMs and have a disaster recovery backup in Azure so that you could take that and restore either to a VM in Azure or somewhere else or back on-premise if you wanted to. So there's a lot of cross pollination between on-premise and in the cloud types of services. You can host your DNS there. You can use their machine learning services. And there's just tons of more, right? It's just really too many to list at the detailed level. And then there's also a page that you can go to that has information about what is Azure. So if you wanted to get more details, there's a link in the presentation, and I'll put all the presentation materials up on GitHub, and at the very end there'll be a slide you can take a picture of or whatever, write it down, where the things will be. I've created a GitHub repository. I haven't put it up there because presentations are always in flux. The scripts are always in flux, so I've made some last-minute changes, but I'll get them there in the next day or so. And then, of course, there's detailed documentation, so here's a link to that detailed documentation. And it will tell you more than you want to know about what the services are, how to create them, how to work with them. So how big is Azure? And there's 30 data centers throughout the world that are up and running and online today. 30 data center regions. What that means is that in a region, there can be multiple data centers, physical buildings that have machines and equipment in it to manage all the Azure services and offer up. So today there's 8 public regions in the US. There's 6 additional government related regions. It's in 15 countries, and Microsoft jumps up and down and touts that there's more regions than AWS and Google combined. So in terms of their spread across the globe, especially if you work in an international business. I have a friend that works at the GM Innovation Center over in Chandler, and he's a database administrator. And one of the problems that they had is that they've been trying to take everything outside that they've outsourced over the years and bring it back in-house, but they can't bring all their databases back into the U.S. They actually have to have some of that data kept overseas because of government regulation, things like that. So that's what Azure is trying to do. That's what all the cloud providers are trying to do, is make sure that you can use their services wherever necessary. There's 8 more regions coming soon. A key point here, though, is that not every service is available in every region. So sometimes they roll services out in preview, and they're only available in a select number of regions. So you can't just go to every region and expect to be able to roll out the exact same VM, the exact same web service or machine learning service or something like that. And they do upgrades, and they roll those across different data centers. So some of the new capabilities, even after they've implemented something, they will be implementing that update in a particular set of regions and then roll it to the other regions, so that if something goes wrong in that update, they aren't killing every region and every service that people have. And if you find that something goes wrong with your stuff, you can, depending on what services there are, you may be able to easily or more difficultly transfer that over to a different region while they fix the problem, whatever that outage is. So here's a map. I don't know if you can see that very well, but here's a map of all of the regions as of last week. And the green dots show where they're up and running. The blue dots are the regions that are in development. So how do I get started with Azure? And there's several different ways to get started. There's, of course, videos here. I've got a link that you can look at, and it'll take you through 5 or 10 minute videos to explain how to bring up a VM, how to create a website, how to create a database, all of those types of things, just kind of quick and dirty types of hello world, as I call them, types of introductory videos. But you can, anybody can get a free $200 worth of credits to use within 30 days and go out and play with an Azure. And what Microsoft says you can do, depending on the size of virtual machine and the other things, size of databases that you create, you can provision 14 virtual machines, 40 SQL databases, or 8 terabytes of storage for a month. You can also build web, mobile, and API apps. So if you have a backend API that something's talking to, you can develop that and put it there and then have mobile devices that talk to that API. Other services like Redis cache services, search, content delivery network. So if you don't want to use Akamai or something like that, if you want to use the Azure CDN, you could do that. And then you can also pump your big data up there, process it, and then shut it down and see how much credit you have left. And I'm sure that probably if you had 12 email addresses, you could get 12 months worth of free $200 worth of credits. It's just you'd have to move things around. So even more reason to understand what templates are, so that you can rebuild that stuff very easily, because that's what templates do for you. If you have a MSDN subscription, either through where you work or personally or in some other way, you get up to $150 in free credits every month. They reset so that you can use those credits with that MSDN subscription. And we have that through where we work. If you have MSDN or some type of Visual Studio with MSDN subscription, it might be worth asking about that to see if you can take advantage of that. Another way, which is besides the work account, I have worked with another group of folks, and we created a BizSpark account. Basically, it's kind of for startups. So we had an idea, we documented, you didn't have to write up a whole lot about it, created a website for it, and basically submitted to Microsoft and said, hey, we've got this kind of startup application idea, and you can get 3 years worth of MSDN, Visual Studio with MSDN subscription through BizSpark, and you get $150 in free monthly Azure credits as part of that. And you are able to create, I think it's either 5 or 6 individual accounts. So each account within your BizSpark group gets the $150 worth of credits. Plus, it's like a Visual Studio Enterprise subscription where you can download all the server software. You get licenses, anywhere between 1 to 10 licenses of the products. Download SQL Server, download Dynamics, the CRM stuff. You can download old versions of Windows and Office products and servers, desktops. It's an amazing program that it really costs you nothing unless you graduate and become a real company at the end of the 3 years and want to continue keeping it. And then it's pretty insignificant for the cost of it. I think it's in hundreds of dollars. If you build up a business, we're trying to sell it as an app or use it as an app or something like that and make money off of it, I think it's just a few hundred bucks to keep the MSDN subscription going for some short period of time, like a year or 2 years more. So it's a pretty amazing program. So there's a link for that. And then they used to have a program called DreamSpark for students and educators. And they've changed that into Microsoft Imagine, which kind of matches up to the Imagine Cup. I think every year they have an Imagine Cup where teams of students, I think it is. I don't know that that professors and instructors can submit, but teams of students then can submit ideas, and also the ones that are worthy, I don't know how they whittle it down, but somehow they whittle it down to a certain number. They invite them to some national or worldwide competition where it's kind of like a TechCrunch Disrupt type of thing, only for students, where they can win $4,000, $5,000 for their app or something like that. So the thing about the Microsoft Imagine subscription is that you get some software. You don't get all the software that you get with an MSDN subscription. You don't get all the software you get with BizSpark subscription, but you get some software like SQL Server. I think you get a desktop operating system. You get a server operating system. You get Visual Studio, but now that Visual Studio is pretty much free for most everything, it's not as great. But you don't get any free Azure credits every month. So that's the unfortunate thing. It would be kind of nice to give students that access. But if you wanted to, there are some completely free Azure services where you don't need to pay a dime to use them as long as you're not using too many. So the first one is the app service. So you can build a website and host up to 10 of them on Azure without paying a dime every month, as long as you keep it within a certain number of gigabytes of disk space. I think you get 1 gigabyte either of total space or 1 gigabyte per website. So you could create your own website if you wanted to. You can build some mobile app backends up there. You can use their log analytics and pump 500 megabytes of data up there to process and report on. You can use some of the machine learning capabilities for free. And you also get Visual Studio Team Services, which is kind of like a GitHub or TFS online. And you can create projects up there that you can check code in, manage the code, and you can have up to 5 contributing users to that project without getting charged. I think there's also, but I didn't have enough time to really look into it, all the details. I think there is some build capability so that you could take code that you've built and checked in to TFS Online or Visual Studio Online, and you can do so many builds or have so much compute time for those builds every month as well, so that if you built a product, you could have it actually build in Azure and not be charged for that build time as long as you kept it small.
Hmm. Nice.
So is this like for application developers?
So it's these kinds of things are mostly for application developers, but if you wanted to play and put up a website, I mean, you can make a website any way you want to. Just you could use a text editor and put an HTML, page up there and run it without any problem.
Or an FTP site or whatever?
You wouldn't be able to do an FTP site because it's not the same as a web, you know, a website.
Mm-hmm.
But at least for free, you wouldn't be able to do that. But yes, you could put an FTP site up there. You probably could use the website browsing capability. So it's an old technology. It's an old BASIC where it basically just lists the pages and the folders in your website. And then you could probably use that to download files from if you wanted to. But again, you'd have some disk space limitations.
But it might cost you.
Yeah. No, Active Directory has a snap in 2012 where you could, it actually monitors your users. I'm trying to remember the name of it right now, and I can't. And I'm wondering, I'd like to play with that to see what that's like. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You can actually monitor like every application you go to right from Active Directory. So you can it gives you analytics reports on the files that they access. And then you can see if somebody's using somebody else's account that shouldn't. What is that called? And I know it's in Active Directory for 2012. And I heard that Azure has it on their Active Directory in the cloud. I've heard.
I know they track a lot in of everything you do in Azure. And if you have like a corporate subscription, your corporate security folks, your corporate IT folks can get in and kind of monitor and look at the breadcrumbs you've left behind of what you've done.
I'm talking about actual reports to see everybody that comes to your website on a massive scale.
So that may be part of the analytics stuff
from
a website.
BI. It's probably the
BI or the OMS.
No, there's another one.
Oh, it's the name. I looked at it last year. I wanted to go back to that.
Yeah, I didn't know it was tied directly to Active Directory. I thought that it was tied to the web. The web service, not
it's the, not, it's actually tied to Active Directory 2012.
Okay.
And it's a snap-in that you could use. So now if you run websites from Active Directory or whatever, you can actually get analytics for security and for tracking.
That's neat.
Power BI.
Oh, Power BI? But Power BI is not Active Directory specific.
No.
It's
analytics and reporting, though.
It's an analytics.
Is it mostly for security?
It's for security reporting for like websites and your SQL servers, and it'll report everything right out of Active Directory. It uses users and computers, right?
Probably anything that authenticates and validates through Active Directory, it probably will record and log.
Yeah.
Well, that'd be interesting to see if you maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe January or February. I think Tom's looking for a February speaker.
Yeah, I am.
There you go.
Well, let me
trying to help you out, Tom.
They have something in here called Threat Intelligence Report. Azure Security Center Threat Intelligence Report.
That sounds familiar.
Anyway, go ahead, Tom.
Right.
I feel like I'm talking to myself.
So there's also another aspect.
I'll just have you know we're strategically located.
Yes. If we were sitting next to each other, we wouldn't know.
even
when we asked each other, we wouldn't.
Too.
Yeah. Oh,
that's what I said. It's a trifecta.
It's the Bermuda Triangle or the Tom Triangle, I guess. Is what it is. So there's also the capability to run, or there will be the capability to run Azure in effect on premise. It's something called Azure Stack, and it is meant to be pretty much Azure running in your data center on your own hardware. It's currently in preview. It's being billed as a true hybrid cloud, which means that you would be able to manage everything in your data center the same way you would manage things in the Microsoft Azure Cloud data centers. So if you use PowerShell commandlets, it'd be the same commandlets as long as the services were available within Azure Stack. If you went to a portal, you could go to an internal portal and manage it through a website. Did you have a comment or a question?
Yeah,
Does that also mean the data can migrate around from stacks, from the Azure stack to the main Azure and back again?
I haven't seen that, but if you build things as infrastructure as code, and as long as the Azure stack, and it will probably always be versions behind of what's out there in the public cloud, as long as Azure stack supports whatever you're trying to do, then you could take those same templates, those same scripts, and build things out just exactly the same. I don't know that you'll be able to click and say, migrate this VM or this website internal to external or external to internal. Yeah. I'm going to bet that over time, that Microsoft wants you to pay monthly, so they're going to allow you to migrate anything internal in Azure Stack to the public cloud. Whether they'll allow you to go the other way, I don't know. Right. So, as I said, not all the services will be available. Certainly not at the same time frame as Azure, since they're deploying services and upgrades every day. But and they won't be all as current, but they will have, as they state anyway, that they'll have a majority of the services that people use day to day. The benefits of this is one ecosystem, so you don't have to worry about, I've got to write PowerShell scripts, or I've got to write Octopus Deploy or Chef and Puppet types of recipes and things like that to deploy internally, and now I've got to do it differently in Azure. I can do it all the same way and still manage it. Now, there's going to be overhead with that, and it will require special hardware, at least in the initial phases, because they want to ensure that this will run and run successfully in a production-like load. So the big vendors like HP and Dell and some of the other vendors, there'll be at least three or four vendors that will sell these, you know, racks, basically, that you run Azure Stack in. There's also a promise that they will give you the capability to have a one-node Azure Stack for development purposes. But that's not part of the preview, and I don't know that that's going to be available before they actually release Azure Stack. But they're looking to give you the capability to manage your environment, manage your services in the same way on-premise, in the cloud, and be able to work with System Center and all the other products the same way. So it'll be interesting to see how that works, but I'm sure it will not be for the small checkbooks, right? So any questions about Azure and some of the things I mentioned so far before we start looking at the Azure Resource Manager? Did I lie about anything for the one or two people that are in the room that have seen?
How much is Microsoft kicking back to you for this presentation?
Microsoft is not kicking back anything to me. They gave me my free BizSpark account, so, and I could share it with five of my closest friends, right? So.
Hi.
yeah, Compet is Advanced Threat Analytics, and it is with Azure, as you have it.
Okay.
I just wonder if they have it up so that people can learn it and play with it.
If you have access to Azure and you take advantage of the $200 in free credits for the month, you can use anything.
You can install Azure Directory.
You can create.
For 2012.
In essence, it kind of creates an Active Directory for you with when you create your account. And you can use the Azure Active Directory. And as far as I know, there's no limitations when you get that $200 in credits. The only limitation is that when you run out, you run out. And when 30 days are up, you don't get to continue after that. But you can use anything in Azure for those 30 days up to $200 worth of credits. Oh yeah, absolutely.
So you
can give them a credit card, and every month they'll bill you for whatever beyond that. But
they take a credit card for you to get that $200.
I don't know if it takes a credit card to get the $200. I know it does not take a credit card with the BizSpark setup or the MSDN subscription. So it
when
may
did,
take a credit card,
it,
but
when I did it, I think I had to. I think I had 1 month that I had a $70 or $80 bill.
So that's where you have multiple. Yeah, I think you do, because I tried that, and I appreciate one of my credit card bills. So if you got to have time to do that,
so
you're going to have to jump in.
Go get a $25 MasterCard at the grocery store that, you know, is a kind of a throwaway card, right?
Right.
Use it. Well, Matt Miller does this, right? So for places like Matt Schutz Pool places, they want an ID or a credit card or something like that to hold. So if you give them one of those, right, there's no value to it, right, or very little value to it. And if they lose it or, you know, you forget it or something, it's not a big deal, right? So it's the same thing. Give them a credit card that's got just a couple of bucks on it. And then the worst case is they can charge you whatever's left on that, you know, that disposable card, right? So that's an idea. It may cost you $3 to get the card or $4.
Mine actually had my name on it. They're a gift card.
Oh, okay.
So that's how I got away with that. I don't think they just take one without a name.
Hey,
so you can use any gift card. Huh?
With your name on it.
But it doesn't have to be my name.
No.
This is true. Certain credit cards do have a one-time use capability. I used one for a recurring thing for 1 year, and I just used it one time. It was $1,000, and I didn't be stuck with it if I had
So there's some options there, and I don't know if you have to click something to say, you know, it's okay to charge me, right, if I go over my limit, or whether you can set something up ahead of time. I've not set up one of the free accounts myself. So. All right. So the meat of this is that there's something called Azure Resource Manager. And this is a relatively new capability within Azure. And I'll show you the old way and the new way, or at least the old portal and the new portal, so you can kind of see the difference in things. Azure Resource Manager, or ARM or RM, you see different things in different places. It allows you to organize things that you create or services that you provision in Azure in a collection. And you can manage that collection from a security standpoint, only allow certain users access to that, those services, to manage those, to work with those. You can tag certain resources within there so that if you want to report on how much am I using in just VM costs across all of my resource groups, right? I could do that. Or I could, you know, tag how much disk space for storage accounts, things like that. The tagging is all up to you and how you want to do that. They talk about some bigger companies use that where they have a subscription for the company, and then when things get created, they either automatic or they come through and they tag certain services to certain teams, and then they charge back billing to those teams for those services. And they can run reports based upon the tags to know what did this service cost or what did this team cost me over the course of this month. You can perform tasks within Resource Manager via PowerShell. There's an Azure command line interface. There's the Azure portal. There's REST APIs if you want to write some VB or C Sharp or some other code. And there's other development tools as well that help you deploy and manage things within Azure. The other thing is that there's extensive logging for all of the things you do. When you create a VM, you can go back and look at that. When it's running, when it shuts down, when it starts up, there's all kinds of logging capabilities there so that you can track what's going on, what's happened. And as, I'm sorry, I forgot your name.
Rebecca.
As Rebecca said, there's capabilities from a security standpoint to look at and see the tracks that everybody left and what they've accessed and things. So within Resource Manager, you can create these templates. The templates are written in JSON or JavaScript object notation. Has anybody worked with JSON at all or seen JSON? Okay. So it's a little different, but once you get used to it, it's relatively easy to understand. You can define one or more resources in a template so that you can, if you deploy a VM, you have to define network interface, a network card, you have to define a virtual subnet, and as well as the virtual machine and a storage account, right? So some services require multiple things to be configured. And you'll see that in the and the demo stuff that I put together. You can identify dependencies. So like a VM will depend upon a storage account, and it'll depend upon a network interface. And so within the template, you can say this VM depends upon this specific network interface or subnet, virtual subnet, or storage account, or things like that. And you'll see how that gets generated. There's some nice generators. It's also declarative. You define what you want, much like DSC, not exactly how to get there, because it will figure out behind the scenes what are all the things do I need to do to create that virtual machine or that network given these parameters or these configuration settings. It allows you to create consistent deployments. You can run a template over and over again, and depending on how you write it, you can set up parameters that can be changed for each execution of the template or implementation of the template. So you can give it different values and run that template multiple times, maybe in a development environment, a test environment, a production environment, and you get the exact same configuration in each of those places with just maybe different names or different sizes of virtual machines or services, things like that. You can actually also make changes to templates and rerun the template, and Azure, as it's processing the template, will figure out what's there and figure out what's not there or what's changed and actually apply those changes when you rerun the template, which is kind of cool, right? You don't have to go and destroy the whole environment and then recreate it from the template that you've updated.
Almost like DSC.
Very much like DSC, right? And I'm sure it was much of what they patterned it off of was the concepts of DSC. And then it supports infrastructure as code, so that's my buzzword for this slide anyway, is that, or buzz phrase. People talk about infrastructure as code today, where you can build scripts or templates or other kinds of definitions and configuration and check that in just like you check in source code. And so when you have a certain version of your application, you check in a template that matches up to what types of resources does that version of the application need. And then when somebody wants to roll out a version, maybe an older version, for us, I know we support like 4 major versions back plus a bunch of minor versions in there. And so we don't have enough resources to have multiple machines of every different version that a client has out in the field. And it would be nice to be able to say, okay, here's a template that defines exactly what the operating environment for that should be, and then go provision that when I need one, and then destroy it, throw it away when we're done, and move on and provision a different one and reuse the hardware resources for that.
Has anybody made a serverless infrastructure yet?
A serverless infrastructure.
Yeah, it's called Platform as a Service.
Yeah. So the Resource Manager and Resource Manager templates don't require a VM or anything. So it's pretty much any service that you can provision within Azure, you can put in a template and in a resource group, right? So I could just create a storage account, or I could create a website, and I wouldn't have to have the VM that.
Yeah, that's sweet.
Yep. So here's a bunch of links about Resource Manager and Resource Group. You know, there's lots of information. Microsoft tries to go overboard. Sometimes it's a little too much. You can find too many links on what you're trying to do. But these are pretty much all Azure Resource Manager kinds of things that Microsoft has written. The only thing that isn't is these Quick Start templates and the Quick Start templates on GitHub. There is a GitHub repo for folks to contribute templates, so that they built out certain configurations of things, and they can contribute those and put those up so that anybody else can use. Much like PowerShell has its public repository of PowerShell commandlets that you can download and functions and things like that. So.
What do the templates do?
They basically provision a resource and give you the opportunity to parameterize or fill in the values for parameters of whatever the resources are, right? So there are templates to build out a VM with Active Directory on it. So you can build out an Active Directory just like on-premise, or you can build out a redundant you know, disaster recovery set of VMs for Active Directory or other things, and you just answer a few questions and point it to your subscription and then let it go, right? So it's kind of nice, but it's just, can you find exactly what you're looking for? Maybe that's a little difficult, right? But if you find something close, you can just make tweaks to it.
Microsoft's done a really good job of putting a lot of that stuff that a developer would have to come talk to somebody about at their fingertips inside of Visual Studio. It's almost scary to some degree what all a developer can actually deploy right straight from their desktop right straight into Azure with the proper privileges.
Yeah, and I'll show you a little bit of that, but it is very easy to do a file, new project, create a web app in Visual Studio, and then when you've, even if you haven't touched any bit of code, you can right-click a certain area and deploy, and it will prompt you where you want to deploy, and you can tell it Azure, sign into your subscription, and it'll deploy it in your subscription. And then you now have a website that's the basic, you know, hello world, out-of-the-box .NET website, or whatever flavor of that it is. Just like if you build it and deployed it locally, you can build it and deploy it through Visual Studio. Now, from an IT perspective, that's probably not what you want your production people doing or your clients doing if you're a commercial software vendor, but it gives developers a lot of capability there. And we've had folks on our teams that have been doing some proof of concepts and some experimentation with Azure over the last few months, and that's what they've done pretty much, is that they just go in and they start writing some code. They've watched a few videos, they've read a little bit about it, you know, how you use this particular type of service, and then they follow some steps, they build out the template, run it, see how it works, and then they can deploy it, you know, to a machine locally or in-house, or they can deploy it to their subscription in Azure with their MSDN subscription and show how that works, right? So they've built the tooling in to be able to easily deploy to Azure from there. And I'll show you how you can do that too. I keep saying I'm going to show you. I hope I don't run out of time. All right, any questions about templates or a resource manager at this point?
It's almost like a Docker file, actually. I was looking at
that. Yeah, it's kind of, it's just a definition, as opposed to here's the step by step. How do I do it? Right.
Cool.
Yeah.
Good question.
Sure.
So let's say you build out two VMs or something, or a couple of resources in there. How do you have to hit a public IP to get to this stuff, or how does that work?
So it depends on how you want to set your network up in Azure. If you want to get to it from the outside, then you have to have at least one public entry point. Right, and you can configure load balancers to sit in front of those things. You configure security firewall types of things to sit in front of anything you've got in that resource group or within Azure anywhere. And you can define what ports are open to which particular machines. It's just like a firewall. But if you want to be able to remote into a virtual machine somehow, some way, you've got to remote into something within Azure, and then once you're in there, you could have it like as a jump box to remote into something else so that you have an indirect capability, but you have to have at least one public-facing type of access point. Unless you're in a corporation or you have your own Active Directory on-premise and you want to have that Active Directory extended out to Azure. So there are ways to extend your Active Directory domain out into Azure so that you authenticate to the resources in Azure just like you authenticate anything in your private network, right? And you set up the trust relationships and that type of thing. So there are, and you can set up a private VPN kind of connection into those virtual subnets so that you don't have to have a public IP address, but it depends. I mean, it would be your company and your security practices how people want to do that. So if you're setting up developers or QA or production environment, maybe that's the way you would go. But the only way into that is through a private VPN connection, you know, through a device or through your firewall setting up the software connection, and maybe it can make it transparent. But if you're just you, you've got a BizSpark account, you've got to at least have one public IP address set up so that you can connect into it. So
can you create, let's say you wanted like 3 or 4 connection points, can you do that?
Yeah, I can create a public IP address for every VM individually. I can create public IPs for anything that would be IP addressable. A public IP address is a separate service or a separate resource.
Can you forward ports?
I believe you can set up port forwarding and redirection. Yep.
One more thing. So let's say you have an office of like 200 people. Are there guidelines for internet speed? But let's say you wanted to run everything in Azure, you got an office of 200 people. Are there like guidelines for internet speeds you need?
I don't know if it's like Oracle. How big is your wallet, right? I don't know off the top. I haven't seen information like that, but I would assume that it depends on what you're doing, right? So let's say if you put all your file shares up in Azure and everybody's going to those file shares to download files and to update files and things like that, then if there's a lot of activity, then the bandwidth is going to be, you know, up to what your users do, right? If it's more website types of things, probably the bandwidth's going to be lower. The requirements would be lower. If you want a remote desktop into virtual machines up there, it's probably going to be lower. But if you've got SQL Server up there or using Azure SQL Database, then you know it depends on what you're doing with that. If it's, you know, maybe a customer database that is very small and you can download everything in, you know, a meg or something like that, then maybe you don't need a lot of bandwidth. But if you want to do, like, you've got on-premise databases that you want to pump up and do some type of Hadoop processing on or some other types of analytics, and you're going to pump a bunch of data up there and then analyze it and then bring it all back in some way, then you've got to kind of account for that, right? The thing about Azure costs as well, one other kind of key thing, is that any data going into Azure, they don't charge you for. So ingress is free. Egress, they charge you, you know, pennies on the megabyte or fractions of pennies on the megabyte. But that's something to keep in mind, that if you pull stuff out and you pull out, let's say, you know, 500 gigabytes of data, there'll be some level of charge associated with that. Whereas you can throw as many things you want in there. That's why I like doing a backup solution where you have a copy of your backup out in Azure is pretty cheap, because you're just paying for the cost of the storage as it sits there, as opposed to paying for the cost of putting it in there, right? You obviously have to have a big enough pipe to pump the backup files up there, but you know, there's no charge for the per megabyte going in. And then when you pull it back out, there would be something. So.
And when the prices for the cost for bandwidth that you're spending more on, you're now spending less on your own server infrastructure. You have all that up in the cloud, being automatically updated, automatically maintained. You don't have to pay a service admin to take care of it. So it kind of offsets itself in a way.
Okay, so then along those lines, if you're dealing with where you have very graphically intense applications like Revit, 3D Studio Max, Photoshop, yeah, Illustrator, and you're needing to have someone be able to have remote access to those applications and be able to do that kind of stuff, and then be able to get those high-end images and high-end results. And like, for example, a small Revit model is going to be 50 megs, 60 megs, 70 megs easily. And that's just one model. That's one built-in file. So then along those lines, like if you're having to build a workstation in the cloud, are the high-end GPUs available in the cloud, like you're using on NVIDIA 4000, NVIDIA 6000, that kind of thing like that?
So I don't know all the details about high-end GPUs. I do know a couple of things. I know that they have dedicated GPU types of services for processing data and crunching data and doing machine learning types of things.
Okay.
I think they do have some virtual machines that have higher end GPUs to do video processing and those types of things as well. I don't know exactly how you can choose those, right?
Okay.
Or what the options are. But I do know they do have some GPU capabilities and some specific high-end kind of GPU processing power in Azure.
Okay.
Right. You probably want to do something different. Have the workstation start the process and use the Azure GPUs as a render farm, not really have the whole workstation up there in that case.
Yes, that's one thing, but because everybody's going to this type of a format,
mm-hmm.
I can't put 3D Studio Max on that machine. I have to put 3D Studio Max on something like this. I take that back. The only one I can do it on is the high-end model with the very, very high-end model, but then it's still limited in its capabilities, which you're taking. For example, you can now get a Lenovo Think or a Lenovo P70 or P50s with a Xeon processor on it. And for the applications that are using that and using 64 gigs of RAM, I can't do that on that.
No, that's true.
Yeah, I think if there's background rendering, you know, that you could just let go, right?
Mm-hmm.
Anything that's non-interactive, I think you could push up there and there's either a service or you could put it on a VM and run the rendering capabilities.
Mm-hmm.
But to use it interactively, I don't know how well that would work out for you from a graphics perspective.
And so then tying back to what he was saying earlier, that so is there a tool to be able to say, okay, I have this type of application, I have this number of users, this is going to be my pipe demand, so then I can say, all right, so now does my pipe demand meet my pipe that I actually have?
I don't know of a tool that you can say, here's my number of users and here's the application, what's the bandwidth requirements going to be,
okay.
Right? I think Microsoft probably has folks that would be able to come out and help analyze that and then give you recommendations. But unless you're measuring that bandwidth within your own networks, I don't know how close they can get, right? Because if you're just pumping data around within your own network and you're going to transfer some of that outside, you have to be able to quantify that some way, right? But I don't know that you can just check off and make assumptions, right? Because your average of data movement back and forth between machines or shared drives may be completely different than ours for the same application, even, right? Just kind of depends. Yeah. So, but what it does give you is that it gives you the capability that, let's say you are really stressing your on-premise resources and you need some short-term, maybe a couple of days, a couple of hours, a couple of weeks, resources that you're willing to pay for, right, by the hour, because they charge by the hour, then you can provision those fairly quickly, move things up there, let that run, and then when you're done, shut it down, and then just keep running on the in-house hardware and resources, and you don't have to go buy, say, another $5,000 machine, right?
If I could buy a $5,000 machine, I'd be very happy.
Or a $30,000 machine, or a $50,000 machine, right? You don't have to spend that capital if you know that it's just maybe one day a month or one week a month that you need some extra compute power or some extra capabilities, then you can build that out, have that spin up, use it, and when you're done, shut it down.
Okay, so then along those lines, when you have the combination where the, what was it called, where the Azure's on site?
Azure Stack.
The Azure Stack.
Stack, thank you.
Yeah.
So how is the Azure Stack then is basically a predefined idea about what you're going to be needing on site, like have your own equipment and spin up as you need within your own hardware infrastructure that's already been sort of pre-planned.
So you kind of have to pre-buy the hardware,
mm-hmm.
right? It's not like you can just provision things beyond your capabilities.
Mm-hmm.
What Azure Stack is, my understanding it, and because it's not a product yet, I haven't heard a whole lot about it. I've done a little reading, listened to some stuff on podcasts about it. What Azure Stack's big claim to fame will be is that you can manage those virtual environments and those services in your own data center as if you're managing them on Azure.
Okay.
Right.
And so then
and if you want to transfer things to Azure, then the same scripts, the same automation, the same, you know, templates and things like that will work identically between
okay, so
the two.
In this scenario, sort of say you could have something going on your Azure Stack locally and then say, okay, if the load has gotten to such and such point, then automatically go to the cloud and provision up there.
You could build things in a way. In Azure today, you can build automatic expansion, you know, and contraction of resources. So I would assume that you would be able to do the same thing with Azure Stack, that you could say, I've got, you know, three machines here running, but the workload, because, you know, maybe if I've got an e-commerce site and I know that it's Black Friday, so I need 10 more machines, but I don't have 10 more machines of hardware, but I'm only going to need it for like 10 days. Then you could build that out and have it automatically expand, you know, given the right things that you've written, you know, and automated, you can have that automatically expand. You know, some of it's built in, some of it's not. Now, whether it will automatically expand outside of Azure Stack into Azure will be up to how much detail they implement within Azure Stack, right? But I do know in Azure today, you can build things in certain services that automatically scale for you, and you can set limits. Hey, I want this minimum, this maximum, and then let it scale in between those two endpoints as it needs to, as the demand comes in. Right. Sure.
Another question. Back on the hardware, he was talking about needing like video resources. Can you request like specific processor types, or like let's say I need a Xeon farm or.
You can't necessarily request specific processor types. You can request the number of cores, the memory, the maximum number of disks, those types of things.
So they hide the entire hardware.
And there's different classes of VMs that would. They don't really give you a cross reference to say this class of VM, like a basic VM, would be this processor, right? They don't. And then the high performance, you know, is this processor. But they do have various processors with various capabilities, and you can pick and choose, and we can take a look at that here in a minute. But you can pick and choose as to how beefy of a processor or a slot, how many cores are in a slot. Yeah, that kind of thing. You don't get to pick and choose how many cores are in a slot or how many processors or that type of thing, but you basically can choose a high performance, high end type of VM, or you can choose a basic or somewhere in between, right?
So if you have some VMs in one region, can you like live migrate to another?
I don't know how live it is, but you can migrate things to another region, yes. And I'm not sure that you can do that to every service, but there are at least select services that you can migrate from one region to another.
Can you hot add RIM and TPU?
You can make some changes in a hot mode, but not necessarily all changes. And in fact, I can actually switch, from one class of machine to another. Usually you can provision at a bigger size and then switch to a lower size. But you can't always go from the small. I know you can't go from the smallest size and say, oh, all of a sudden I need the biggest size now. Right? There's some limitations to that. But the guys were just talking about, they had either read or somebody had said at PowerShell Saturday, hey, provision for bigger than what you want and then scale it back. And then you'll have the capability to provision up to what you think will be the biggest size machine later on, but you'll be paying in the short term for the smaller machine.
Can you still shut down the VM and configure the entire VM?
Yeah, pretty much that. You can shut down the VM, and you can actually, for virtual machines, you have a VHD, right? So it'll create a storage account, it puts the VHD in there, and you can take that VHD and actually move it around if you want to without actually moving the machine.
Can you use like SCVMM, right, to manage your Azure stuff?
You can. I don't know exactly how that all works. I've seen a video on it, but yes, they're adding more and more capabilities to the on-site. Yeah.
Could you add like the, can, Can you have like the Hyper-V snap in and just point it to your user address or something? Give you an address for
I don't know how you bridge that. I just know that they've added more and more capabilities, and with the newer versions of SCCM and SCOM, right? That you can report everything in a off-premise as well as on-premise in the same portal and with the same information. So metrics, you know, CPU utilization, disk utilization, those kinds of things, they're bringing more and more of that through one, you know, dashboard or one viewport to be able to manage those things. So I would expect over time they're just going to add more and more and more capabilities to that, right? Because that's what they want. They want you. They want to make it easy for you to be able to take anything on-premise and run it in Azure. And they want you to be able to have no excuse to say, well, it's different in Azure than I'm managing here, so it's going to cost me more. I have to train my people differently and all that kind of stuff, right? That's what Azure Stack's about. That's what integrating with the manager's about.
You going to show us code?
Yes.
Okay. We only got 45 minutes.
Okay. Well, we're not going to get through everything, so maybe we'll have a continuation for more intense things about templates and stuff. But let's just go through the portals. Now I've run so long, people need a bathroom break.
Oh, and to get there, I think you need to go back through there and through that dark room and then around, because I think that front door's locked.
Oh, good enough. And you didn't bring his phone, so he gets locked out.
He's in trouble. All right, so let's just take a quick look at the old style portal. Unless Tom's firewall or whatever blocks me here. So this is the classic portal is what they call it. And you built services using this in a slightly different way than what you build with Resource Manager and all the current and future stuff. There are some reasons why you would continue to use this, because there's certain more user security kinds of things and subscription management things that are still only here or managed better here than in other places, but it's very few things. And they'll support this as long as people are using it, they say, but who knows how long that really is, right? So
AD is still in there. Active Directory is still in ASM.
Yeah. So, and as Tom mentioned, ASM, this is Azure Service Manager. So it's kind of the underlying services are called ASM for this, as opposed to ARM for it, or RM for the other ones. So this is an old account that I built virtual machines in the classic mode and set up environments. Understand that if you go down and look at the virtual machines. There we go. And we walk through and take a look at one. You can see there's a status, you know, my subscription, what region, West US, there's a West US 2 as well. What's the DNS name? So how would I get to this? This kind of equates to the public IP address. And if I look at the machine, you know, I can see more details about the machine here. So there's a dashboard here. And since it's not been running for a while, there's, you know, no CPU, no disk.
Is that core?
Huh?
Is it a core image, a server image? What kind?
It's just a server image, I believe. I think it's a Windows 2012 server image. You can see endpoints that these are the way to open up the ports to this particular machine. And then if you go in and configure, you can see there's two tiers, basic and standard and classic. You can look and see how many cores, what class of machine. The A class is where I've got this machine, so I can expand the memory, I can expand the cores up to 8 cores of 14 gig, right?
And if you go to standard, can you go to more RAM?
If I go to standard, I've got a lot more options, right? So I can go to this D class of machine with 16 cores, 112 gig of memory. But that's not the limit. That's just the limit within the classic environment, right? So yes, I can make changes that way. You can create these in an availability set so you have redundancy built in, right? And
is there a default backup policy, or do you have to define that?
So most everything has redundancy built in, although it's not guaranteed. The availability sets help guarantee redundancy. So storage, the storage that VMs are hosted on, those kinds of things. Azure SQL databases, your data stored in Azure SQL database, there's actually three copies of that data, or three copies of that storage. You only see it as one, but there's three redundant copies, and then you can define for that storage whether you want it to be locally redundant within that region, or within that data center within the region, region redundant, locally region redundant. So it could be at any data center, you know, or basically I think they try to, if they've got two data centers or multiple physical data centers in a region, they'll split your data, at least one copy of it, to another one. And you can go geographically redundant so that there's one copy possibly overseas, one copy on the other side of the country, and one copy on your side of the country, right? So there's different tiers and different layers that allow you to define that redundancy. And then behind the scenes, if they figure out something is wrong, they automatically repair it. You'll never see that. As best as they can do, they'll make sure you never see that. All right, your mouse stopped working for me, Mike, or Tom.
I hit the control key.
It's showing me.
Use the pad? Oh, great.
Azure crash.
Can I turn off the mouse?
Yeah, something? if you collapse it, it'll turn it off.
Collapse it like...
The other way. There you go. That's off. Here, just unplug this. Unplug this.
Okay.
That work?
That works. Okay. All right.
I don't know why it stopped working all of a sudden.
So you can see all my items here. There's some directory stuff. Mostly it's virtual machines that I've created. And, you know, there's storage accounts to store the virtual machine images and the temporary storage for the disks.
How's the storage compared to S3? Fast?
I don't know anything about S3. I've never used S3. So, sorry. I think there are premium storage, so let's hop over to the regular Azure portal.
The ARM portal.
Yeah, I think you can choose between spindle and solid state. Yeah.
You can.
Is it like a Glacier thing? It's almost like a long-term storage on Amazon, where it will take like a day to recover any data from there, but keeps terabytes of data. I'm not sure. It's like tape backup.
Oh, yeah. This, when you select this stuff, it's more than just we'd rather have spindle or solid
so it's
state.
Active.
Yeah. I think the Helmick on PowerShell side already said there's a nice premium to the SSDs.
Yeah, they don't do them for free for you. You're already signed in.
Yeah,
now it tells me I'm signed out. Let's see where it goes here.
Yes.
Ah, the cloud tiers. So let's try shutting down some of the. I may have created.
Is that Batman?
Yeah, it's me. I'm Batman. That's from when we had a Halloween party in Austin.
Your head was Batman.
Something like that. I have this, that'll make a collage for you, all your favorite pictures, and that's what I do. It just switches it out every hour. Between Pontiac and BMWs and pictures of her and I and
Batman.
Places we've been.
All right, so this portal will look significantly different than the other one. And immediately, your first page is a dashboard that you can customize. There's some things that come out of the box, like get started. There's a region kind of status indicator. I've added some widgets here that show me how much I burnt down of my $150 in credits. So this is just one of the accounts, you know, one of my BizSpark accounts. I created extra ones just to make sure I had plenty of credits, right? And then, you know, this shows you costs, right? There's a virtual machine called Win10 Dev. Another one, My Windows VM. You know, some stuff that I was playing with. This shows me what the cost has been for the, you know, since the beginning of the month or since my credits reset. And then you can plug in a bunch of widgets here. You can edit this dashboard to put a lot of things in it. So if we take a look, there are virtual machines here. And the list looks somewhat similar, but it's quite a bit different. So it still tells you the status, tells you the resource group now. So resource groups weren't a capability that you could build something in Classic. Although behind the scenes, when they implemented resource groups and Resource Manager, they took all your Classic stuff and kind of put it in a resource group for you, right? So even though you're not creating Classic things or didn't create Classic things in a resource group, there's one that's kind of hidden. Again, the location, if you click on the machine, you get more details about the machine. So this tells you the operating system, the size. There's my public IP address and the DNS name, my virtual subnet, what region I'm in. I can add tags, as I mentioned, and whatever tags that I want to put in here, right? I can see the activities, starting up and shutting down the machine.
Every single one of these things he's showing you, there are commandlets for every one of them.
Right.
Every one of them. Once you attach your Azure account, you can get any of that data that you see in there, or create any of that data you see.
I can look at the disks associated with it. So there's no extra data disk, there's just the operating system disk. I can look at the network interfaces. The NSG is a network security group. We can take a quick look at that too. You can look at the sizes and change the size. Right, so you've got all the A's, basics, right? F sizes, F16s with 16 cores to 2 gigabytes. And then,
so if you're creating a storage device and it's just for a backup, for example, I'm assuming you can choose to have just a regular level of spin up hard drive for cost reasons, or is everything going to be an SSD?
So if I'm creating storage just to create storage, not as part of a virtual machine?
For example, I'm going to do a backup in Azure. So I just want to be able to store the data there and be able to access it if I need it, so I don't need to have an SSD level storage.
No, you pick the class of storage that you want when you create the storage, right? Okay. Or if you create a VM through the wizard, then it will create the class of storage just basically for the VM, and you can choose a hard drive, a spinning hard drive, or an SSD. But it doesn't really give you the capability to give you premium storage with higher IOPS necessarily. Okay. Although different classes of virtual machines that you can provision. You can see here, you know, the D1, V2 standard gives you 2 times 500 max IOPS, right? This one gives you 4 times 500, 8 times 500. And this tells you it's local SSD, right? If you get to the more beefy machines, you know, there's 32 times 500 max IOPS, right? And then these are just the machine sizes that I can put a Windows kind of desktop operating system on. Servers get provisioned in a different way, right, with different selections that you can make. Right. So if I look at the overview, I can click on the public IP address, take a look at that. I can change the DNS name if I want to. I can ask for a static IP address, or I can just use the dynamic IP address. Right. And you'll see that your DNS name actually gets prefixed into whatever region you're in. So this was provisioned in the West US2 region. So it becomes westus2.cloudop.azure.com. So of course that means that your VM name has to be unique within that region. Right? And if it isn't, when you change it, it goes through a process. Like if I put that in there, it'll go through a process and you'll see it kind of over to the right there, you saw a little box being drawn. That's it validating and checking to see if that VM name is valid or somebody used it already. There's also some limitations on uppercase and special characters in different places, and it'll validate that there for you.
Can you have a subdomain?
Not by just provisioning it this way, setting it this way. Okay. I believe that you can create subdomains, but that's a little more sophisticated,
yeah,
right?
Website.
All right.
Do we support clustering?
So you can build VMs and then cluster those VMs, yes. Yes. And in fact, there are actually templates out there in GitHub that you can build out a clustered set of VMs, right?
What does that mean? We're going to see the code? I'm sorry, Tom. I just have to give you crap.
All right. So if you wanted to create a new VM, you can add a VM. So let's walk through that process because that generates the code for you.
Yeah, agreed.
Okay.
See code.
So I can go down and search for whatever I want or take some things that are off the shelf. So here's a summary pretty much of the different types of VMs that you can create with things pre-configured on them. Different Linux distributions, SharePoint on it, Visual Studio, BizTalk Server, Windows, SQL Server.
So for example, the Cisco piece, I'm assuming you're getting the different versions of routers and switches, et cetera.
I've not used the Cisco and looked at it. I can't tell you what the capabilities are, but I don't think that you can specify that I want a specific Cisco router.
Can you click it?
Router.
And then the other question is that, for example, in that Cisco, are you using Cisco commandlets, the Cisco command line interface to manage it, or are you using tools within Azure?
I don't know anything about Cisco, and I've not used any of this. So for this, the description talks about you can create a Cisco Cloud Services router, right? Which is this version of a Cisco router.
So you can have whole IRS that's totally virtualized. Yes.
I think that you could probably run native Cisco command straight on.
That's the feature you want.
Yeah.
Teaching somebody how to use it. Hey, Dave, it's nice. Cool. Azure environments.
All right, so let's build out a Windows server so Tom can see some code. So we can pick whichever Windows server that's offered here. So we'll pick Windows Server 2016 Data Center Edition. It asks you, do you want to create it as a classic or resource manager deployment? So we want resource manager.
One thing to notice with Resource Manager, it's a lot easier to be granular about the permissions you assign compared to the ASM stuff. The ASM being the older resource or the service manager, you can only assign the permissions at the subscription level,
right?
As opposed to individual resource groups gave you the granularity of being able to assign permissions from your AD to individual resource groups and items underneath them.
It gives you a lot more
better,
flexibility.
A lot
yeah.
more capability with it.
So if you create something within Classic, can you go to Resource Manager and not vice versa?
So you really can't deal with the things that you created in Classic in Resource Manager.
Okay.
And you can't deploy a Resource Manager template in Classic.
Okay.
you would have to write classic, the ASM
mm-hmm.
style PowerShell to do that.
Okay.
Right?
Is there an export import utility where you can shut it down?
And... to move from classic to resource manager, probably there's that way. I've not read anything about it, but I know that there's not going to be something to go back the other way, right?
Just use resource manager.
So earlier this year when we started, we've been at Pulse, we've been working on it for a while. They had a lot more stuff. And what they call classic in the portal that now has moved to Azure Resource Manager. So everything is kind of moving what they call classic, which is ASM, which is the older portal that he showed you, into this particular portal here. And that's a lot better portal than the old one. A lot better.
Yeah. So I'm giving the machine a name, pick an SSD for the storage, setting up a user ID that will be an admin user, giving it a password and validating it. Of course, I didn't validate it. There, I got it right. Telling it which subscription I want to use. I want to create a new resource group, give it a name. Where's the location? And I can pick from any of the locations, right? So.
Zill. Do they charge more per location?
The location can affect the pricing, yes. So if I click OK here, the next steps in the wizard will give me prompts for the size. And it'll give me some standard ones, tell me what the estimated cost per month would be, or I can expand and view all of the servers and the estimated costs. And with my BizSpark subscription, I don't get all of those high performance options because it probably suck up my BizSpark $150 in credits in about 5 minutes, right? Just provisioning thing. So some things aren't available. To giving your subscription, or if your company says, hey, I don't want to offer these out to everything. So, but you get an idea, at least for the VMs there. It'll give you an estimated cost, give you some idea of, here's 50,000 IOPS, 32 data disks, right? Premium disk support as opposed to regular disk support. So I'm just going to pick one core because I'm cheap.
Can you add additional drives on the blog here?
Through the wizard, I don't know that there's a way to add additional drives through the wizard. You can add them after you provision the initial machine, though.
Yeah. Can you expand drives?
Would you want to, then?
Absolutely.
Well, they have a different thing called Azure Storage. You would use that for all your data storage. Use that to keep that redundant backups, and then have the virtual machine, like your base operating system, just access the storage for the storage needs. You wouldn't really want to keep any of the actual active data on your virtual machine. You want to make these nodes as thin as possible, and then you can scale it. Hey, you want 20 of these? Got it. All accessing the same data within Azure Storage.
So you get a storage, they set up a storage account for you, and there is some minimal configuration, and I talked about redundancy. So with this class of machine, you get locally redundant storage. With other classes of machine, you get different. It creates its own unique name, puts it in a slightly different domain. Interesting, right? I can also configure some things about the virtual network, the subnet, right? The public IP address. I can again set the static versus dynamic, right? And then I can set up the network security group or the firewall. And by default, you get the RDP port, but you can add additional inbound rules and configure.
Port 80, yeah.
Configure to your heart's content, basically, right? So we'll just leave those as defaults. And now we get a summary page. It's doing some validation. It's passed the validation. And the big button is OK. But if you click OK, you don't get to do the download template and parameters. Right? So I've already downloaded that, expanded it. Basically, you get a zip file with several files in it, right? That would allow you to run and create this. So I'm going to go ahead and click OK for right now and let this kind of percolate in the background. And then we'll switch over to my virtual machine and I'll show you the files that it creates.
Is that server 2016?
This is Windows 10.
Oh, okay. That's totally. I haven't seen 2016 yet.
Yeah, so this is the zip file you get. You get, oh, you want to see Windows 2016?
Yeah, it's all right.
Okay. I'll give you a user ID and password to show you later.
Right next to the code.
So this is a zip file. You get a deploy PowerShell script, a deploy bash script, a deploy, I think this is a Ruby script. You get a deployment helper C#. I believe it's a class. You get a parameters file and a template. So I've pulled those out of the zip file. I've put them in other places. And so if we want to take a look at the PowerShell, right? This is the guts that Tom wants to look at.
Well, that's why everybody's here, right?
Right.
It might be open already. PowerShell 7 is open.
Yeah. It probably wouldn't have opened. Oh, there. No? Nope, it's not open already. All right, I'll just open it from here. So this is what it looks like. Better?
Yeah.
So it's got help information, always nice. It's got a list of parameters that you can feed into this script for the subscription ID. You can name the resource group here. You can set the location here. Give the deployment a name. Point it to the template file and point it to the parameters file. Right? And then it... it's got a function here that it defines to be able to make sure that all the resource providers for Azure are registered, right? And then it goes through, it's got comments here. I mean, I don't even have to tell you what it is. You can read through the comments, right? Sets the subscription up, logs into Azure, checks to see if there's a resource group already for that, and then, you know, the big bang is right here, starts the deployment, right? Using the parameters file and with the other information you passed into. Big bang, boom.
Is the shell script this complete?
It's, yes. So if you look.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah, it's even commented here too. And with the bash shell and PowerShell. So then the parameters file's not as interesting, but it predefines the answers.
Can you change them?
You can change them. You can use a text editor. It's going to open it up in Visual Studio here for me. So these are basically the things that I answered, right, when going through the wizard. So what location did I want the machine? What did I want the machine name to be? What size, that class of machine? What do I want the min username? Where do I want the storage account? The virtual network name? All of the things that you could then change, right, as part of that.
You can define the load balancer and everything as well, not just a virtual machine in this template, right?
You can define everything in this template. So when you look at the actual template, so it defines the parameters as what parameters am I expecting from a parameters file, right? And it defines the type. It can also define certain restrictions on it, like is it, should it be from this value to this value? What's my default value? What's my list of values? And in my next version of this talk, I'll talk about that, I guess, since we will run out of time. But I'll show you one thing. That's right. So you can see, you can set up the parameters, then you can set up variables. And you can
volunteer for February.
Exactly. I give the rest of my talk in February, right? I actually can make this a 3 or 4 part series because I can put desired state configuration in this too and show you how you can automatically have desired state configuration run if you want. So then each of the resources defined individually in a block. So this first I must have collapsed some stuff somewhere or lost it. But I must have been playing around with this and moved some things around or lost it. So you define each resource. So you need a storage account. You can define the type, which is basically kind of the internal code name for it. There's an API version. As Azure spins up new versions and new capabilities, they have different API versions. They only support so many months or years backwards. And so if you take a template that you built, you know, this year and 4 years from now, it may not work unless you update the API version. But then the account type, the value for account type is coming out of the parameters, the storage account type value. So that's how you refer to a parameter. If you want to refer to a variable, you use variable instead of parameter and then give it the variable name. So you can program these templates to some extent as well. So you set up the network interface, the NIC card. You see that this depends upon certain things being in place, like the virtual network, the public IP address, the security group needs to be in place first, and then all of the information about it. And then here's where you're defining your firewall rules. So this is where it's showing up to say, okay, allow RDP in, and you can extend this as well, right?
So we're getting kind of close.
Okay.
If we're going to be out here today.
I'll show one other quick thing. So I copied this and created and made a change so that I could define my DNS name. So in the wizard, you can't define the DNS name necessarily easily. So I created a separate solution to show you how within Visual Studio it gives you the IntelliSense. And I'm using Visual Studio Code, or Visual Studio Community, not Visual Studio Code. I'm using Visual Studio Community, so that's free. And then there's a slide in the deck that just basically tells you you need a certain version, 2015 Update 3, with the Azure SDK installed as well. So why didn't that have what I was expecting? I wasn't expecting to use my virtual machine. Go back to the previous version of the demos. There's nothing there. Why? my solution file disappeared. Oh no, it's sorry, wrong demo. It was actually in 9, and I did it a little bit differently. So it wasn't the port. I changed it to allow me to select things. So if you create a template through Visual Studio, you can do a file, new project, and create a cloud solution. I'm going to run out of time for this, maybe. You can create a cloud solution and a resource group, and it will go through and build out a basic project and solution in Visual Studio. And like I said, you can use the Community Edition, and it works just like the paid version of Visual Studio. So here I've built one out. The PowerShell is a little bit different looking when you build it out this way. It doesn't have as many comments, but by and large, this will deploy it, the VM, right? And if you look at the parameters file, this is a shorter list of parameters. It doesn't have everything in it. It's not as flexible when you build it this way. But if you go in, you can actually change and add parameters to it. So if this data center 2016 wasn't there, if I commented it out, I can get IntelliSense to put it back in. So I can put a comma. If I click return, you'll see there's a squiggly there. And then I can put in 2016 data center. And now all is good. There's no squigglies.
So since you're pulling from the Azure server for the images, or is it?
It's taking the information from the Azure SDK,
okay,
and then all of the internal files for that, right? And you get IntelliSense for all of the template stuff, right?
So it's dynamic.
Right. And so from here, I can right-click. I don't know how to right-click with your tab. Your pad.
Two fingers.
No, it's not.
Yeah. So I can right click a deploy and create a new deployment of this. I can create a new resource group. So let's change the name to resource group instead of VM. I can pick the location. Create. I can edit the parameters. Put in my username, my DNS name for the public IP, and now I can choose in a dropdown, because we've got those allowed values over here, I can choose one of those allowed values in the dropdown and provision a machine. Right? Save that, run it, and then it brings up your log within Visual Studio's output window. Right? So I can also monitor what's going on. I'm going to log into my account. So this is the PowerShell commands. So I can take a look at all the resource groups in my subscription. And because I started provisioning the resource group 1 and 9, then you can see them show up here. Right? If I want to see a deployment on resource group 1 to see how it's progressing, I can see whether it's still in process or whether it's succeeded. So the one we created through the portal, we can see the status update on that. And then if we look at 9, can see how that's progressing. Let's see, it's still running. And if I want to find the resources that I provisioned, I can bring it up in a grid, and I can sort within the grid, and I've got the resource group name, and then all of the different resources that have been created in those resource groups. Right. So you can manage, you can see, you can create all within PowerShell as well, if you wanted to do it that way.
Okay, we're about out of time.
Yep. So I apologize that I had a lot more content than time. It's better that way, maybe. So
good job, Tom.
I will put stuff up on GitHub anyway. And if you want to take a picture of the slide real quick.
So just so that anybody, just out of curiosity, was this worthwhile and should we do another session like this?
Yeah.
Okay. So cool. We can dive into this again probably in February since I've got something lined up for January. That'll make it easy for me.
February and March, maybe.
Yeah, okay.
More PowerShell. So there's there's where the repo will be on GitHub. And I'll put everything up there, so if you want to play around with some of the stuff that we never got to, you're more than happy to play around with that.
You want to make a comment about the ARM commandlets?
The ARM commandlets versus the
non-ARM
commandlets? So we can make a quick comment, I guess. So if you manage classic resources, you have to use the Azure commandlets. If you manage Resource Manager resources, you have to use the Azure RM commandlets.
Okay. If there's pizza left, if anybody wants to take a box home with them, please go ahead. I'm sure they'll like it. Help yourself.
So thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Batman.